Welcome to Know Thyself, yet another episode with much more insights, and I'm sure you're waiting for it. Let's get into today's episode. Welcome, Father. Welcome, Sister. So yet another episode and much more details into the character of this blind man from Jerusalem. So we did discuss one half of it. I'm sure there's more to it, Father. Mm-hmm. You can take us through.
Yeah, in the last episode, we discussed the problem of being blind. Born blind. And we have gone into this question, who is responsible for this person to be born blind, himself or his parents? And neither. So we had gone into a little bit of the curse of the sins of the parents coming down to the generations, etc. Now I read the paragraph once more, and you see about the blind man himself. As he passed by, he saw a man blind from his birth. And his disciples asked him, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Jesus answered, it was not that this man sinned or his parents, but that the works of God might be made manifest in him. We must work the works of him who sent me, while it is day. Night comes when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. As he said this, he spat on the ground and made clay of the spittle and anointed the man's eyes with the clay, saying to him, go wash in the pool of Siloam, which means sent. So he went and washed and came back seeing. The neighbors and those who had seen him before as a beggar said, is not this the man who used to sit and beg? Some said, it is he. Others said, no, but it is like him. He said, I am the man. They said to him, then how were your eyes opened? He answered, the man called Jesus made clay and anointed my eyes and said to me, go to Siloam and wash. So I went and washed and received my sight. They said to him, where is he? He said, I do not know. That is the first sight, first episode, the first part of the episode. Here is a man who is born blind, he's a beggar, and Jesus sees and somehow gives a revelation. The question is answered, is neither the sin of this person nor that of the ancestors, but God's glory must be manifested in him. So the fact that Jesus is going to heal him is going to show how God is giving light. So by giving sight to the blind, Jesus himself presents as one who is the light of the world. So this is a sign. The sight to the blind becomes a sign of God's revelation as the light. Remember, the first creation was light.
Right.
So let there be light, and there was light. We don't see light. So when Jesus says, I am the light of the world, I used to ask the students in the seminary, what does it mean? I am the light of the world. Do you see light? Of course we see light. Where do you see light? There. Is that light what you see? You don't see light. You need light to see, but you don't see light. You see the bulb, you see the tube, you see the instruments. Am I right? Do you see light proper? The light enlightens, but you don't see light. You cannot see without light, but the light you do not see. So this is something. No? When Jesus says, I am the light of the world, I am the one who illumines the world.
Wow.
So light is a medium through which you see. If I have a glass without any color, if I put a yellow glass, I see everything yellow. If I put a red glass, I see everything red. So the light somehow enlightens. And if the light that is given is red, I see everything red. So what does it mean that I am the light of the world? I give you a perspective. I give you the means to see the world. So you have to see the world through me. So the way, that is a vision. So as long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. See the world through me, through love, the truth. So that is what Jesus said. So Jesus is the light of the world, is illumines, and he is the means through whom we see the Father, we see the other. When I see you through Jesus, I see you as my brother. I see Jesus in you. But if I have another light, I see you as my enemy. The other is my enemy. Because I don't have the light of Jesus. So the light illumines and gives a sight. Illumines your sight and gives you a new perspective, new vision. So this is what Jesus said. That's what he is going to give. And then the next, so that is the purpose of his coming. I am the light of the world. I illumine everything. See through me. And then he makes a paste with a spittle and mud. And we have already seen the blind man of Bethsaida that Jesus put the spittle in his. So this is a sign, but this also becomes an instrument for further further discussion. Now, puts this paste on his eyes. Go and wash. So he is given a command, go and wash in the pool of Siloam. Siloam means one sent. So this has a grammatical as well as etymological meaning, Siloam, the one sent. Because this is a pool of Siloam, where they have an aqueduct bringing the water into the Siloam from abroad. Mm-hmm. So the fountain or the water that is being sent to this pool, the one sent. So this has an implication that Jesus is the one who is sent.
Wow.
So the Siloam, Jesus is the Siloam, Jesus is the one sent. The name of the pool is somehow symbolic. It has a very practical etymological meaning that the water is sent from outside to this pool, so it is called Siloam.
Mm-hmm.
But this pool becomes a metaphor, a symbol of Jesus who is sent by the Father. And he's the one who sent, and he's the one who is giving the healing. So he goes and washes and comes seeing. And now the reaction. So far there was nothing difficult, but now when he comes and sees, people is asking, is he? Is he the same? Is he not? No, he looks like that, he's not. Some say. So the reaction of a person, when the person starts seeing, there is a reaction, there is a kind of disturbance in the community. Remember the possessed of Gerasene, when the person lost his demons, he becomes a point of attraction and Jesus was somehow cast out of that. So why are the people so much disturbed by a blind man seeing? And this man, one, has something to say. I was blind and I see now.
That's it.
Oh, how did it happen? He knows. A person called Jesus put a paste in my eyes. He asked me to go to wash in Siloam. I went, I washed, I see. So this is a conviction. This is something, a person who has come to a conviction, he has come into contact with Jesus and he gained something more than a physical sight. I think Sister Kim will have something to say in this procedure.
He has gained his identity. In that sense, that I think it's good to think about the position of the, just like the women, anybody who is handicapped in any way was cast out of the society. They were unclean. And they were convinced that that person is cursed by God, not loved by God. It was to this person that Jesus comes out, makes the paste, put it on his eyes. And he doesn't keep it there. He tells him to go and wash. This water, it's like in the Old Testament, the leper was asked to go and immerse himself in Jordan. The same way, the direction he has to follow. He had to do something. So our cooperation is needed in our healing. It is just not taken for granted or given there. So this man was asked to do something, and he did it. And so he was healed. And in healing, not only his sight was restored, his identity was restored. He came to know who he was. He was no more afraid of the people. The people disturbed asked him, who is he? Is he the same one? Or somebody else looks like him? Is this double? No, he says, you don't have to doubt. I am the one who was sitting there and begging. Now I can see. I am no more the beggar. I am no more the helpless person. So the helpless person has become healthy and helpful. And that is disturbing. You see, sometimes when we see a person who was very weak and passive becomes active and forceful, gee, questioning. And this is the thing what we is questioned to the authority in that sense. Until then, he was a poor thing sitting there and begging they can throw anything onto him and he didn't care. Here he can see now what he gets. Mm-hmm. And that is threatening. When somebody else's growth becomes, my identity becomes shaken up with that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But it doesn't affect him. He is strong about it.
Right, right.
I am the one who was sitting there. He was not afraid of his background. Mm-hmm. And that is a healthy attitude in the sense, my background is, okay, I was a poor, unloved person who was sitting there, but no, he did not ignore his background. Mm-hmm. He was ready to accept the negative side of his background and then to claim what has happened to him.
But sister, I have a question. Psychologically, why does it happen when somebody, there's a growth in someone? Some people are not happy about it.
Because,
the scrutiny,
see, and especially if I am used to manipulating that person.
Oh, okay.
Okay?
Okay.
Or take advantage of the another person's some kind of deform, then I cannot do it anymore. It's like I give to a child, I remember once, the grandfather gave a $5 into the hands of the child. And he had learned to look at, he was, oh, it's 5 rupees. Oh, you can read it. So he took it back and gave him 10. Because, the reason, because if he knows the value of what he is getting. And no more you can teach him. And this is what happens when the poor people, the Dalits, when they, people went in there and taught them to read and write or to count. When they're getting, instead of getting 20 rupees, when they got 2 rupees, they said, this is not the agreed wage.
Right.
Give me my 20. And that is threatening to the people, those who are in power. Yeah. And this is why when the other person is grown, somehow that person is no more subjected to be manipulated by me anymore.
Right, right.
So if I want to manipulate somebody else, I had to keep them weak.
Yeah.
When they become strong, it is, I make a person strong when I don't want to manipulate, I want that person to walk up.
Right.
If you lie down on the floor, I can stop on you.
So there could be some counselors also doing this, like we discussed in the previous episodes, mm-hmm. You know, who just want to have control, and I think they should let go of this.
Yeah, I think there is a need of empowering.
Empowering.
And you are afraid to empower the other. You want to make it too dependent. May counselor, maybe a superior, maybe a political leader, who wants the other to become independent?
Right.
The more people depend on me, the more profit I have. I have the prestige, I have the power, I have the profit, everything. But if I let you grow mm-hmm. and become independent, two things can happen. I may lose influence on you, but you can be also a threat to me.
Right.
So there is a saying in the Stray Birds of Tagore, mm-hmm. the woodcutter's axe asked for a handle and the tree gave it. And you know what happens now? So when the woodcutter's axe has a handle, it will fall at the root of the tree. So it is also dangerous to make others powerful. So you are threatened by the others unless you want to present, take the person as an equal.
Right,
so
right,
as long
right.
as you are dominating the others, profiting from him and making your prestige out of the subservience of that person, you are in danger.
Mm-hmm.
So the moment you make the other person powerful, independent, self-sufficient, you lose control over him, then you have an equal. So you have a partner, not a servant. And how many wants a partner?
So I feel as counselors, we should be more generous. Just give.
We have to.
Yeah.
I mean, that is the meaning of counselor instruments. Empower that person to work on their own.
Yeah.
Not to depend on me. And in counseling, we are saying that I should not have a psychological dependence on my client. Because having that person depend on me makes me feel good.
Right.
My
right.
goodness should not depend on that person. So independent. You grow up, you get on your feet, go on your
Empower.
Way. And even in relationships, even in friendships, in the sense, for us to demand that person to come and tell me everything or whatever they want, okay, you come and tell me whatever you want. If I compel on that person has to depend on me, that is not giving independence.
And that, I think, what Jesus said, I will call you no more slaves.
Wow.
I call you friends.
Friends.
Because I told you everything I heard from my Father. So you are no more servants.
Mm.
Jesus doesn't want anybody to be servant. And that is specific of the Christian religion, the Christianity. Jesus wants no slaves. Jesus wants free persons, free children of God. I called you friends. So Jesus wants friends, and that is what he gives. So all the miracles he performed, the woman who was bent, he unbinds her.
Mm.
She stands up. The paralytic who was paralyzed, he gives them the strength to the feet and the hands, and he can walk.
Mm.
So the lepers are cleansed. So here, everywhere, we see the work of Jesus as empowering. Reinstating the humanity, the free nature, the freedom of the children of God in every individual. So this is what is happening here. But then there is a problem.
Mm-hmm.
When everybody become free, there is the danger that those who were exploiting from the slaves will lose something.
Mm-hmm.
So the counselors also may have the same problem. If everybody becomes independent, what is needed of a counselor then? What am I going to do? So it can be the political leaders. So if everybody become free, independent, then what position do I have? So the first thing, I think, if the counselor asks the counselor, have to realize, I am here not to dominate. I am equal. So who said all are equal, but some are more equal? So I cannot be more equal than the others. So what Jesus wants is every human being to be equal. Equality, fraternity, liberty.
Wow.
That is the values of the kingdom of God. And that is the values the French revolutionaries took up. Egalite, fraternite, liberté, liberty. So we have to go further into this character. The first part we have seen, he came back seeing, and there is a disturbance among the crowd, the dispute. Is he the same person or not? And he says, I am. And they ask, where is the one who healed you? I don't know. Now, when I continue to read, verse 13 following. They brought to the Pharisees the man who had formerly been blind. Now it was a Sabbath day when Jesus made the clay and opened his eyes. The Pharisees again asked him how he had received his sight. And he said to them, he put clay on my eyes, and I washed, and I see. Some of the Pharisees said, this man is not from God, for he does not keep the Sabbath. But others said, how can a man who is a sinner do such signs? There was a division among them. So they again said to the blind man, what do you say about him? Since he has opened your eyes, he said, he is a prophet. There is a second stage. See, I wonder why the people are so troubled. So the people discuss, he was blind and not blind and etc. And then, I was blind and now I see. Then why do they take them to the Pharisees? The Pharisees are the religious leaders. As if he has committed a grievous crime. So it's a problem, see, and it's a crime. It was on the Sabbath day. So on a Sabbath day, making clay is a sin. And if it's a medical practice, so according to the Jewish law, a medical practitioner is allowed only so much to do as to keep the person alive. Only in a life-threatening situation is he allowed to intervene medically. But this man, he was born blind, there is no danger whatsoever. And this particular person called Jesus makes a clay and spreads it on his eyes and sends him out. So punish. So something is against the law. So the people consider it as a sin. So this man becomes the witness and is an object, and he is brought to the religious court. And he's being questioned. Very strange. A very strange religion. And I think we have a lot more to learn from this. So he's questioned. And then he says, this man doesn't keep Sabbath. So if he doesn't keep Sabbath, he's a sinner. Then the question, will God work a miracle through a sinner? So there is a dispute, there is a division. See, a division already in the people, now the division among the religious leaders. But the simple fact that a blind man has started seeing, this is a danger that goes further. But I think we don't have the time to finish it today. Sister may have something to add to this.
I think it is very relevant today also. When we see somebody is grown, somebody has gained, empowered, people, especially the ones in authority, becomes scared, threatened. Then they question and trying to find some way of putting down that person who did it, who caused it. First you put down the person who experienced this growth. Any time somebody, a subject to question an authority, they are scared. I remember once I'm saying about my course in the sense it is making people too free to question. What they want is really everybody obey me without questioning me. Right. Okay? So it is really exalted in saying that obeying without questioning. At the same time, obeying has a responsibility also. Responsible obedience. You have to be not only the human beings, but you are also responsible to God in that sense. To Jesus, who never lost an opportunity to do good in the name of law. But when you are imposing the law on a person, and if the person asks, why do I have to do this? We must be able to give an answer. If I cannot give an answer, the law is not valid. And so sometimes I see that people, those who are in positions, are saying that this is what is told, do that, and that's it. You cannot question it. And that's not what Jesus was encouraging or helping people to do.
I think the counseling is a process of empowering persons.
Right.
Coming out of one's own problems, become aware of one's problems, and one's also aware of one's dignity. You take possession of your own life. And you are become an independent person. You don't depend on the counselor anymore. You don't depend on anybody but God. It's a person with a responsibility. I am responsible. Ability to respond. That is responsibility. I am able to respond to the questions God asks me. I am able to respond to the questions people ask me. I have a responsibility. I have the ability to respond. That I think what the counseling should be doing. Provide the ability to the person to respond. But then a person who is able to respond can become a threat. So he will not take any command just for the reason that you are a superior. If he is asking something unreasonable, you will ask, why should I do that? Or why did you do that? So remember, Jesus had told us, show the next cheek to the one who strikes you on the one cheek. But that's not what Jesus did. To the soldier who struck on his cheek, Jesus did not turn the next. He asked, why did you strike me? Tell me what did I say wrong?
Right.
And if I did nothing wrong, why did you strike me?
Right.
And this is the ability to respond. And I think that's what Jesus gives. Not succumb to an insolent might. Not become subservient. Become a slave. A responsible person who can stand straight. And that's what the counseling of Jesus, and I think every counselor should have that ability to provide.
So that brings us to the end of another episode. In fact, powerful one, where we understand that we are no more slaves, but his friends. Yes, the Word of God says, if the Son sets you free, you are free indeed. And where there is freedom, there is the Spirit of God working. So if you have any questions and suggestions, you can write to us on knowthyselfdtv@gmail.com. Let me repeat it. It's knowthyselfdtv@gmail.com. Till we meet you in another episode, God bless you and keep you safe. Thank you.
Thank you.